So things get sticky in today's holiday games. And our co-host is Christian Slater. All next on Live. Now, here are Kelly Ripa and Christian Slater.
What is better than this?
Nothing.
Nothing is better than this.
It is
alive.
Thursday, December 22nd, 2016. Back today is Christian Slater.
Hello. Good to be here.
Christian, I've got to tell you that I did not realize it is your wedding anniversary, right?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you have...
That's right.
You sort of have a dual wedding anniversary, right?
Well, we did December 25th. We did it Christmas Day.
Christmas Day.
To keep it sort of an intimate... Yeah, that way not everybody could come.
That's very smart.
You know, yeah, we had a huge engagement party for, like, the family and the whole thing, but our wedding was actually about 14 people, so that was very small, very intimate, and very lovely.
May I show this picture?
I didn't know this was coming.
I have to show it to you because this is... I cannot believe... This is like a movie set.
Oh, yeah. Look at that.
Look at you helping yourself.
I was very, very happy there. Yeah. That's a lovely place. It was in Rockford, Illinois. It was a little bed and breakfast. And, my wife was like, do we really have to go outside and take a photo? I mean, it was freezing cold. Freezing.
Right. But, and she's from Florida, right?
Born and raised in Miami, so cold climates are not her favorite.
Right, right.
But I said, love, we have to do this. And we went out there and got this photo, and I think it was worth it.
Mullen, come on. So we were theorizing. We were like, well, this must be in a castle in London.
Right. Nope. Rockford, Illinois.
Okay, well, there you go. It's gorgeous, and it's worth it. The picture's fantastic.
Isn't it great? Yeah.
Yes,
and I picked the dress, too, by the way.
Did you really?
Yeah, I did.
No kidding.
Yeah, I went and... Picked the dress. I wanted sort of that mermaid-y thing happening, and I got into it. She tried on some things. We did a whole fitting, and yeah.
Who are you?
Is that crazy?
Oh, my gosh. You are perfect.
Well, she picked the suit, so I picked the dress. That's how it went, yeah.
You are the perfect man.
Oh, come on. That's too nice.
You know what?
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Did you know, did you guys know that today is National Regifting Day?
Oh,
yes.
Very special.
Yeah. Today is the day where you gather everyone round, gather them round the, whatever your non-denominational plant is in
your house.
Whatever
that is,
right?
Yes.
And you give them stuff you don't want. I am a big regifter, but I always, I tell people when it's a regift. I believe that's the way you regift something. Mm-hmm. You're
open and honest about it.
Yeah, I got this. Yeah. I thought of you. I know you like this. This will be better for you than it would be for me. Because you don't want to give somebody a gift that they may try to return and find out what if it was something that came in a gift bag or a goodie bag or whatever.
So they're
saying that there should be rules attached to regifting. This day is unique because it appears it's a common day for companies to hold their annual employee Christmas parties.
Oh.
And sometimes you're given lots of crap you don't want on that day.
Sure.
So it's a nice day for all of us to gather around, tell stories, have cocoa, and
here's
give each other stuff
want.
We didn't want.
Here you go.
Yeah.
Take it off my hands.
Yeah.
Here was something that I thought was fascinating, which I did not know actually existed, but... they're finding that messy people may actually be smarter and more creative than neat people.
Wow.
What a relief.
Wow.
Yeah.
Are you messy?
Oh, I was going to ask you the same question.
So it's very funny because all of my actor friends are slobs.
Really?
They really are slobs.
Wow.
Like, I walk in and I go, you live like a pig, and yet you're in the movies.
How is this possible? Right, exactly. Right.
But I married a man, you know Mark.
Yes.
He is fastidious. He is a neat freak.
Right.
He is clean. It's almost like we live in a hermetically sealed environment.
Wow.
So
with
he
kids
has made
too,
me.
It's hard.
It's very
yeah,
hard.
Yeah.
He has made me. He has made me incredibly conscious about being neat and clean.
Oh, okay.
Our children are neat and clean.
Are they?
Except that I've seen my son will FaceTime me from his dorm room, and I see that, and he's a creative.
Yeah. Okay.
He's an artist.
Yeah.
And I see that he is living in complete filth. So I believe
he's letting it out.
Yes, he's letting it out.
He's
there.
Letting the filth flag fly.
Hey.
Filth flag fly.
Good
is
for
that
you.
Good?
You did
you like
it.
That? Thank
yeah.
you so much.
Stuck that
yeah.
landing.
I got that out there.
Slater stuck the landing, everybody.
Yeah.
Good.
I am neat, and my wife is, my wife is neat, but likes one room to destroy.
Messy?
Yes.
Huh.
Yeah, so, and she's a genius. So
she a genius?
Yeah, exactly.
She,
yeah.
You know, I met her at our Christmas party where we are so starstruck by Christian that we forced him to take pictures with us all
night. I think I forced everybody to take pictures
no,
with me.
No, it was embarrassing.
From
I was
what
like,
I recall
guys?
Is I was getting, people were saying, okay, that's enough.
No, no.
Yeah.
No, I was saying that's enough. I was like,
all
guys,
right.
release Christian and let him have, like, something to eat. He's weak from all of us bothering him for photos. So... listen to this.
Yes, listening.
This is cold and flu season. I've got some hacks that will fight off colds in minutes, including sipping black tea and nibbling Brazil nuts.
Ooh.
Yeah, Brazil nuts. So a lot of people say chicken soup. Yes, chicken soup is a great preventative. The broth prevents the buildup of, I hate this word, mucus.
Oof, gross Ugh. Word, disgusting.
Mucus is yeah. a terrible word.
Yeah, yeah.
I hate it more than moist.
Ooh.
I hate it more than the word crotch, which is a word I love. I actually love the word crotch.
You like that word, okay.
I say it on TV because it makes me laugh.
Right,
I don't know
right.
why.
You can get away with it.
You can
fine.
Get away. It's,
yeah.
a, it's one of the few words that you can get away with saying on
Isn't
TV.
Isn't that weird? Yeah, my wife has, again, I'm talking a lot about my wife, but...
Yeah, because your anniversary is coming
That's
up.
What it is.
Wait, what number anniversary?
Three.
Great.
Yeah,
okay.
we've been married
That's
3 years.
That's the diamond anniversary.
Ooh.
You know
very excited. Oh, okay.
I always say that.
I'm working
always,
on that.
I always
yeah.
say that.
Good,
I like
good,
to advocate
good.
For the ladies.
All right. Very, very nice. Yes,
yeah.
But she has one word that she doesn't like. I learned it on our, I think it was while we were together about a year. I think I just proposed.
Okay.
And then the next day, I used this word, and she lost it. And the word was bib. Hates
bib?
The word bib.
Bib?
Yeah, and it was like, how am I supposed to, such an obscure word.
Bib?
Yeah, bib. B-I-B.
That's
Don't
such
say
a
that
weird...
word to my wife.
That's such a weird word.
I know. Not one that I would have predicted or...
How did you come to use the word bib? Anyway.
I think we were eating lobster.
Oh, a
That's
lobster
what it was.
Bib.
We were in Maine, we were eating lobster, and I said, does everybody have their bib? And she was like, oh, I hate that word. Yeah.
Ginger and garlic. Also, if you ply yourselves with ginger and garlic, not only will people stay away from you,
mm-hmm.
making you less likely to catch a cold,
Smart.
But they also stave off colds. Isn't that correct, Gelman? Dr. Gelman, everybody. And do some yoga.
All right, so what do we got? We got on today's show?
Yeah, Kira Sedgwick is
yes.
here.
Yes.
Yes.
Series designated survivor, Cal Penn.
Yes!
I love him.
DJ
Kelly!
That's
a new
band.
I know, it was so fun. I love that. And we will play our next holiday game when a lucky member of our studio audience could win $500.
Yeah, I like this. It's time. Oh, yeah. Let's
oh, cover, what do we got?
Cover our
oh,
coffees.
Oh, smart.
It's
right.
time for Lives a Party Travel Trivia.
Yeah.
Boyd from Dallas, Texas. A lot of twerking for your holiday pleasure. How about that?
Yeah.
Good job.
Look at that.
Yeah. Yeah. We like it. We like it a lot. Hey, on
Very
the phone
nice.
Is Paula Monroe from West Seneca, New York. Why don't you take her off hold there,
okay,
Christian?
Okay, I'll take her off hold there.
Okay.
Hey, Paula.
Hi, Kelly. Hi, Kristen.
Hey.
Happy holidays.
Thanks
and to you
too.
As well.
Yeah.
Thank you, and happy anniversary, Kristen.
Oh, thanks so much. That's lovely. Thank you. 3 years. The diamond anniversary.
The diamond anniversary.
Yes.
What do you do for a living, Paula?
I run a home daycare.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah.
How many kids?
Oh. Normally I have 4 or 5 during the day, but today I only have 3, so I feel kind of lucky.
Yeah, right. I'll say.
A little break.
Listen, nice. Let's spin the wheel, see what you're playing for. This is a great prize, the Hyatt Regency Huntington Beach Resort and Spa in California. 7 days, 6 nights. It includes 1 spa treatment per person. This trip is provided in part by Hotels.com. It's a prize valued at $4,400. You have 20 seconds and only 1 guess, Paula. Good luck.
Okay, here's the question.
Okay.
We've had singer Trisha Yearwood on the show. Outside of what city did Trisha say she and Garth Brooks live and have a farm?
Twenty cents. They have a farm.
Google it.
City.
Google.
4, 3.
Take a guess. Guess the city.
Nashville.
Yeah.
Congratulations, you and a guest will enjoy 7 days and 6 nights at the Hyatt Regency Huntington Beach Resort and Spa, a luxurious oceanfront resort with shimmering views of the Pacific Ocean. The Spanish-inspired architecture sets the scene for a memorable retreat, along with endless activities, including several outdoor pools, beachfront access, a luxury spa, and more. Your prize is valued at approximately $4,400.
She was typing away.
Oh, my gosh. That is wonderful.
Paula, congratulations.
Thank you so much, and thank you, Google.
Hey, yeah. I mean, honestly, Paula, take your time.
I know.
Now you get to help make the day of a lucky member of our studio audience who will receive a $500 gift certificate from Omaha Steaks. So please pick a number between 1 and 235.
Number 2, please.
Number 2.
Another lucky member of our studio audience could win $500 as part of our holiday games. We'll talk with DJ Khaled from designated survivor Cal Penn. And coming up next, Karen Sedgwick.
So long since I've done a talk show.
Really?
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. It's sort of a surreal experience. Hello, everybody. Good morning.
You know, you and Christian worked on a film together that I remember very well, yeah. Murder in the First.
Yes. Right, with your husband, Devin.
Yes. Do you remember that?
I do. No, it was a very special, important day, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that was crazy. The location was crazy.
Yeah. It's set in the prison.
The Alcatraz.
Right.
Yeah.
Murder in the First.
That's right. We got to shoot in Alcatraz, and you had that phenomenal scene.
Yes.
It was great.
Yes.
It was a great scene.
Yes. I was brought into, as a process. Well, wait a second.
Hey,
I think we need to set this up a little bit.
We do. Yeah, sure. Right.
Okay.
I'm the lawyer for Kevin Bacon's character.
And you play a hooker with a heart of gold.
Yeah, that's, he has not been, Kevin's character had not been with someone for, ever, really.
Right.
And,
forever,
right?
Because he was put into jail at a very young age.
Exactly.
It was a really tragic
and
story.
And so I, as a kind lawyer, and I went and found his wife. There you go. Yeah, it worked out.
We were very married at the time. Like, let's be clear about
that. Well, you guys, I mean, you two have been married. I cannot believe I'm about to say this because you look like you're 28 years old, but you've been married for 28 years.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah.
Now, you have recently, did you direct Kevin in some?
I did. I just directed my first movie. It was incredibly exciting. Amazing.
Is it harder? Yeah. I'm going to ask both of you. Is it harder to star in a movie or to direct a movie?
It's so, I found it honestly a lot easier to direct.
Mm-hmm. Really?
To be perfectly honest with you. It's so much less stressful. Have you directed?
I directed a long time ago. I did something, and what I found was, which was lovely, is you don't have to worry about being in front of the camera at all.
Exactly.
Pressure's off.
Exactly.
All the pressure's on the guys who have to be in front of the camera.
I know.
Yeah.
I know.
That was your experience.
I think once you've done that, you really know how exhausting that, how hard that
but
is.
But you directed Kevin.
Right. Yes, I directed
how
Kevin.
How is he actually as an actor?
Any challenges there?
I think if the whole musician thing doesn't work out, he's got a future.
Really?
You think?
I'm thinking.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, he's amazing. Yeah. I mean, and he's hilarious in the movie, and he has a smallish role, and he's wonderful, and it was so easy to direct him, and, you know, he takes directions really well.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
really?
You know.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I always.
Is that how it's been, like, even in your life, in your marriage? Has he listened?
Oh, yeah.
I think that's the wisest. Yeah, it's the right move.
That's why we've been together for 20 years.
You got to listen to the wife, right? That's true.
Only because they're always
right. We're usually right.
More in touch with the flow of life than we will ever be.
Yes. Yeah,
we need more women in charge, please.
That's right. Yes, please.
Yes. Now, and you have one hobby that's unique.
I like bowling.
That's crazy.
That's it, though.
Bowling.
Are you a good bowler?
Oh, my
bowler?
God, just three people went.
Bowlers.
Bowling is great. I love bowling. I love taking that little ball and hitting all those little pins very far away.
Yeah.
And it's one of the few things that I actually do better than my husband's.
Oh.
Do you have your own ball?
No, I don't have my own.
Don't.
But I have my own shoes.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Well, that's more important.
I have my own shoes,
quite
frankly.
Yeah.
And now this movie. So, this Edge of 17. I watched it. I loved it.
Isn't
it was
great?
Incredible.
Yes.
Listen,
yes.
We have to take a commercial break, but we're going to talk about it.
Okay.
And talk about being a good mom in general when we return. More with Kira Starr. You've got good upper arms.
It's a great movie. It's an incredible movie.
Loved it.
It's one of the best movies about teenagers that I've seen in decades, really.
Yeah. The angst and struggle that she's dealing with there is just fantastic.
It's brilliant. It's funny. It's incredibly poignant. It's James Brooks, executive produced it, who's a genius, and Kelly Fremon Craig, who's a first-time writer, director, female, obviously. Yeah. And it was an incredible experience.
You play Haley Steinfeld's mom.
Yeah.
Are you a good mom?
Are you a good mom or a bad mom?
She's a terrible mom.
Oh.
Terrible. She's a terrible mother. But
single mother, right?
But single, her husband died, and she knew he was the better parent, and then he dies, and she's faced with this daughter who's so much like she is, who has all the deep-seated insecurities that she does. So I think as a parent, first of all, every mother thinks they're doing a terrible job. I don't know a mother who actually thinks they're doing a good job.
Right. Anytime they think they're doing a good job, they're usually the worst parent.
Exactly.
I'm a wonderful mom.
Yeah. But I think that it's so hard when your kid reflects back to you like everything that you dislike about yourself.
They do hold up that mirror. Yes.
It's so hard. I mean, you know.
We've been talking about this for
days. Seems to be like a real subject.
Is it harder to be, would you say, a 17-year-old girl or the mother of a 17-year-old girl?
That's a really good question.
Yeah.
I really wish I had the answer. I mean, my first instinct when you asked me that is, well, it's harder to be the mother because the 17-year-old girl, like, it's going to get better.
Uh-huh.
I can guarantee you it will get better.
Right.
But for the mom, maybe not so much.
Did you have a good teenage experience? Like
I did.
Your
I have to tell you. Oh, my kids?
Yeah, you're...
I thought you were talking about my kids.
No, I had terrible. Oh.
No, I was the misfit toy. I was a total misfit toy at school. I mean, all the best people really are.
Yeah.
The people that like have bad high school experiences, in my experience, grow up to be the best people.
Yeah. You don't want to peak in high school.
No!
I say it all the time.
That should be horrible.
Do not peak in high school.
Right.
If you peak in high school, that's it. There's nothing else.
Yeah, not going to get any better.
No.
That's right.
It's so true.
Yeah, you want to keep growing.
Yes, exactly.
Were you in musical theater in high school?
No, I didn't. Well, actually, that's not true. I did. I found acting when I was 12, but I started working professionally when I was 16.
Oh, wow.
But before then, I was like ganged up on at school, like not physically, but, you know, verbally. And, I mean, girls are mean.
They can really be so mean.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's tough. No.
The audience is like, yes.
pretty heavy. Yeah, no, it's really funny though, because my
you have a daughter.
I have a daughter. She's 15. He has a daughter who's 15.
Wow.
And separately, not together. But I was saying, because of the TV show Glee, musical theater has become really popular, and popular kids do it now.
Right.
And when we were kids, like musical theater, right, you got picked on if you were in musical theater.
There was more judgment.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
it wasn't cool.
Yeah. It wasn't. Yeah. You could find your people though.
Right. You did find your people, yeah, but they were the people that everybody picked on.
Yeah.
So you were in that.
But then you would band together and pick on them.
No, not really.
No, it's hard to get, yeah. But it is. It's nice to find your troop, your tribe,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
It is nice to find where you do fit in. And now, you're right, like you said, you have a rough experience and you grow from that and you
That's
become
right.
a fantastic person.
And you
person.
Have a lot of compassion.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Understanding.
How old are your kids now?
23 and 27.
Your kids?
My kids are 23 and 27.
No, that is crazy.
That's crazy.
Yeah,
I was just
going to
give
happen?
You advice.
I don't know.
I know. I have a 17-year-old son and a 15-year-old daughter, and it is astounding.
Yeah.
Where does that time go? And my son is taller than I am as well.
Yeah, all of our kids.
So he's 6'1", so you try and you're like, you know, teach a somebody taller
back.
Than you a lesson. It's impossible.
So make sure you check out.
Cool to be here. I've watched your show and it's
so nice to have. I can't believe it.
Yeah, first time.
No kidding.
Wow. Welcome.
Yeah,
welcome.
Thank
and
you.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
It's a big
yeah.
deal.
Thank you.
Now, have you two worked together?
We haven't worked. We've traveled together.
We've traveled together.
Yeah, we've had some adventures together.
Tell me about that.
We did a USO tour.
We did a USO tour together. I think two or three different countries. I want to say 4 years ago, 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, we went to what? Ethiopia, Djibouti.
Djibouti.
That was an adventure.
Which is neighboring sort of Ethiopia. It's one of the countries in which we have an operating base.
Wow.
You were very brave. Remember we got sort of stuck in Ethiopia at the airport. We were there.
We had a layover in Addis, in Ethiopia, for about 6 hours. None of us could leave because you have to have a yellow fever vaccination.
That's right.
Really?
But I just spent the whole time looking forward to getting to Djibouti because remember they were selling T-shirts that said I was all up in Djibouti?
Yes.
Yeah.
Seriously, this is a real. A lot of the Marines and soldiers had these shirts made at the base and were.
Did
were
you
like,
bring any of those home?
I think we got. Didn't we get one?
I think so.
I got
one. Oh yeah.
I should have worn it underneath.
Videos.
Pretty great shirt.
Djibouti is a fun. It's a fun word. To say.
It is.
It's such a wonderful word.
Very nice people.
Yeah, very good. Yeah. So now, Harold and Kumar, House, and now Designated Survivor.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
I love that I could do all the...
But you took a break from Hollywood, and you went to work for the White House. Explain to us all how that happened.
I think in the context of stoner movies, it sounds weird, right?
Yeah,
how did you make that jump?
Right.
It actually wasn't so different. You know, in 2007, there was a writer's strike when I was on House, so you couldn't really shoot anything.
Mm.
Right around the same time, I had read the president's books, and I had a lot of friends who were overseas in Iraq. You know, met some of them on these USO tours.
Right.
Didn't have health care, couldn't afford college, and here was a guy who I thought had some pretty good plans to make that happen. So I went to volunteer for his campaign, and he was the underdog at the time, right? 30 points down in the polls and all that. And then just had the chance to grow with his campaign and couldn't figure out a good way to say no when they say, can you serve your country? Like, obviously you say yes.
Of course.
Wow.
Playing
a
fake doctor.
Did
you work directly with President Obama? Did you have some...
I was in an office called the Office of Public Engagement.
That sounds like a great office.
Yeah.
It was cool. I liked it because you end up meeting the real people who are affected by all these policies. And I worked mostly on outreach to young people. So I had a great... You know, you'd see the president whenever you're... whenever you've got to brief him on something, in my case, related to young people. But
so you were in the Oval Office briefing him and doing those things?
Not like every day. In your head, I know you're like, in there every day doing.
Yeah.
I was in there a few times, but it's kind of, you know, you...
Look, a few times. I mean...
No, it was amazing. I am not trying to downplay that. It was very cool. I remember the first time I was
it's
excited.
It's such a remarkable choice to make, to be an actor, you're doing well, you're successful, and then to go into that particular world. I mean, is there a similarity? similarity between the two worlds in any way?
I think what's interesting, like, what I did, I think, got some attention because I was on a TV show.
Sure. Time,
but there are literally thousands of people who do the same thing.
Yeah.
Every administration, really, especially this one. Right. Doctors, engineers, you know, college professors take a leave of absence and go serve their country and then go back to what they were doing before.
But now on Designated Survivor, I mean, don't you approach your job now with a certain amount of expertise? Like, guys, this is not how it is. This is all wrong.
Yeah.
We would never put this here.
Exactly. I've been there.
Guys, I know how this goes.
Yeah, in some ways, yes. And I think it's oftentimes, I think, disappointing to the creative process, right? We have this conspiracy theory-filled drama.
Yes.
Right.
And I'm the idiot who comes and goes, yeah, that Secret Service guy wouldn't be standing there.
Yeah, right.
I mean, who are you? And they're like, yeah, I know, but it makes really good TV. So we're going to make him stand there. Anyway,
it's,
you know?
It's a really beautiful shot.
You know, that's what you want out of a fantasy show anyway. So.
Yeah, it's true. Listen, we have to take a commercial break. When we come back, we're going to find out why certain areas of the set are off limits on the show Designated Survivor. More with Cal.
Tune in Monday on Live for our annual Viewer's Choice Special.
Give thanks for Tom Hanks.
That was Cal Penn on the show Designated Survivor. Of course, now you play a speechwriter.
I do. I play a speechwriter turned press secretary.
Turned press secretary. Yeah. I see.
You all had to, like, get new jobs. I mean,
the premise of the show is, and this is the premise is actually a real thing.
I didn't know this was a real thing, by the way.
It's a totally real thing. So at the State of the Union, you know, there's every representative of the entire U.S. government. So God forbid if anything should happen, there has to be a backup plan, a contingency plan.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That, and so there's one human who's part of the cabinet who's a designated survivor, somebody who can take over if things go down.
Is it a random drawing? Is it they draw straws?
It's not quite drawing straws, but I don't know the full process. I wasn't working at that level at the White House.
Right.
But there's a process to choose that person. And in our case,
Kiefer. Eeny, meeny, miny.
Basically. Kiefer plays.
You like that? Kiefer, he's amazing,
secretary.
Right?
He's awesome.
Yeah, he's the greatest.
Awesome guy. And he's just thrust into this insane job.
A lot of responsibility all of a sudden, in one moment.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
I cannot believe this. I mean, it's every time I think about it, I go, well, this can't really happen. And then when Kiefer was here, he was like, no, this is a real thing.
Yes.
This, you know, there is one person that if, God forbid, something happens to everybody else, he assumes or she assumes the presidency.
Yes.
Right? It's really...
It's nuts. And we hope, you know, obviously that wouldn't happen.
Of course.
And our show starts with that premise and then sort of runs wild with it.
Do you have a White House? Do you...
Set?
Yeah, how's that? What's the set like?
It couldn't be farther from the real White House. We shoot in Toronto, Canada.
Oh,
so, okay.
And we have a Canadian president, so Kiefer's Canadian.
Right.
But they've done such a great job building the set. The Oval Office is I think, to scale. It looks
real. No kidding.
Yeah.
So cool.
After that, other rooms are in the wrong place. Like, they're not in the place that they are in the real White House, which is kind of fun and a little bit confusing.
That's cool.
It's neat. It's neat to see them. They've really
Do you ever make, like, a wrong turn?
Sometimes. When I first started, you know, you'll go one way and,
so
like, that's not where the room is.
He'd be walking in and go, guys, it's over here.
Yeah, what are you doing?
The other big thing, they were trying to match the opening scene I have with Kiefer and the pilot is in a bathroom, and they were trying to match the bathroom as best they could to real bathrooms there. Except there was one key difference when we were shooting, the prop guys had to put up a photo of the one thing that we couldn't do, which was actually use the bathroom, because it looked so real. They did such a great job doing
it. Wow, it was
not
so authentic.
Not real. And I was.
And I like that they kept it. They kept the language simple for the actors. Not real.
Right. Yeah, they didn't go overboard. They're like, just so you know, actor.
Yeah,
you can't really use this.
Don't
real.
Yeah.
Oh man.
So that was a key difference.
Yeah. Would you ever really use the toilet on set?
No.
No.
Come on.
Go home.
Yes.
Gotta go home.
Yeah, right. You're a home goer.
Yeah, exactly.
You're the guy in the dressing room bathroom.
Yeah.
All right, so listen, Designated Survivor, right? Wednesdays at 10 p.m. On ABC.
This is a chart-topping rap artist, producer, and one of the most famous celebrity DJs in the industry today. Please welcome to the stage, DJ Khaled.
welcome.
This will officially make me cool in the eyes of my children.
Oh, man.
I will officially be cool. Yes. How are you?
This is what we call a major key alert right now.
Write that down. Is that like low key, high key? Is that what you're talking about?
I mean, that's just saying, you know, the keys. I got the keys to success, more wins, more blessings.
Oh,
I see. And this is a major key because it's your number one show.
Oh, Whoa. Thank you very much. This is where you belong. By the way, I love your satin jumpsuit.
Oh, thank you, thank
you. And I love your glistening watch.
You know, gorgeous. You know, this is the way I glorify my success. You know what I'm saying?
You know,
sometimes you have to reward yourself, because if you wait for somebody to reward yourself, you played yourself. Don't wait on nobody. Reward yourself.
Yeah, there you go. Beautiful. You started your DJ career early, right? You were a teenager.
Yes, I started probably like 12, 13.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? A garage, you know, a bunch of turntables, a bunch of records, posters of my favorite artists like Biggie or Jay-Z or Tupac, or, you know what I'm saying, even like, you know, Sam Cooke and, you know, Stevie Wonder, Michael Jackson, you know, just all this beautiful energy around me and my drum machine to make beats and, you know, Mike, this
you were
living
making
a dream.
Phone calls too, right? You
oh, yeah, calling, making, yeah, yeah. I'm making a lot of phone calls. I used to work at a record store.
Right.
And, you know, I would sell tapes and CDs and records, but I would get on the phone, you know, when the boss wasn't there, and they had, you know, long distance. So I would call all the record companies and execs trying to get a record deal. You know what I'm saying? And like, you know, and the phone bill would come every month.
What's going on here?
Like, yo, how this happened?
Yeah. You are incredible. Be like, that's incredible.
Yeah.
Okay, so number one, you had an unbridled ambition. You had a real desire to succeed. Yeah?
Absolutely. You know what I'm saying? You know, my whole career always, you know, took my DJing to a whole nother level. I never just did one thing, you know what I'm saying? I'm a music executive now, CEO, We the Best Music. Mm-hmm. I'm also have my own management company, I have my own publishing company, I have my own restaurant, you know what I'm saying? And not even just that, man, I'm for the people, you know what I'm saying? It's all about the people.
Yeah.
And I live off that energy, you know what I'm saying? That book is coming.
Good. I was going to say, because I want my kids to read it.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that.
Life lessons,
It's so interesting, though, when I think about you, you are the coolest guy ever. Were you born cool? Like, there are people that are, you know, there are people that are, like, chic, but there are people that are born chic, right? You're like one of those guys, I think. Like, you were a cool
kid.
I'm definitely special cloth alert.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I'm definitely young icon.
Right.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, we all blessed, you know, we have life. You know what I'm saying? The minute you come out, your mother, you know what I'm saying, we have life. So we can accomplish anything we want to do. And that's the biggest blessing, that we have life. Because some other people don't have life, and we have it. Look at us.
Right.
We're on the Kelly Show. We live, and we vibing. You know what I'm saying? We vibing. We blessed. We all blessed.
I adore you.
Thank you.
I really adore you. This is exciting. Okay, we're going to have more with DJ Khaled when we return.
If you'd like to know more about anything you see on Live, log on to our website, livekelly.com.
I love
Got the keys.
Yeah, oh my gosh, it's amazing. It's everything.
Yes.
So now, Christian and I, we're saying we have so much in common with you because we're also DJs. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, let's not go crazy. Yeah.
No. But you're amazing. You just have a natural musicality and ability to hear music in a different way, right?
Yeah,
is that what DJing is?
Well, you know, DJing is you know, we all parts of music, because we hear music, we have to keep the crowd moving,
right?
But at the same time, is when you become a producer and a DJ, we know certain parts that the people like when they're in the club or on the radio. So you could take that whole talent and take your career musically to a whole nother level, but it's on you, though.
Yeah, but you have to read the room, right? Like,
you have
to know, like, okay, right now this crowd.
I gotta make these people move.
Right.
Yes.
And some DJs just play music and they be like a jukebox. Me, I like to entertain.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? I'm a superstar.
I'm gonna make sure
I have this crowd, and when I leave live from Kelly, they're gonna remember my name.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And by the way, I do have an album out right now. It's called Major Key.
Major Key. Okay. So can I show you how to show you? Yes, yes. People to know my name when they leave the studio,
Sure.
So, check this out. We're going to immediately get him on the floor.
Okay.
Asher, you scratch.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Take over.
You scratch?
Nice job.
Grab it. Let it go.
Games in honor of Hanukkah, the miracle of one night of oil lasting for 8 days. It's customary to have treats fried in oil. I did not know that, Gelman. Yeah, how about that?
Yeah,
who says food. This show doesn't educate? Now, to celebrate that tradition, today we have a jelly donut challenge.
Oh.
We've selected a lucky member of our studio audience to play, and today's contestant is Lindsay Connard from Bethlehem, Pennsylvania.
Lindsay.
Come on out.
Hello.
Hey, Lindsay. Hi. Hey, Daddy Christian.
Hey. Pleasure. Nice to see you.
How about that?
Pleasure.
Big movie star.
Oh,
huh?
Great.
I know. Nothing but the best for you, Lindsay.
In this game. Yeah, I know. It's a great app.
I know. I was like, is this your very own poncho?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right. Well, in this game, you'll have 30 seconds to get the donuts off those strings and run them back into this bowl. That sounds easy, right? Well, there's a catch. You aren't allowed to use anything but your mouth.
Yeah. Hey, hey.
That's right. Every donut you successfully get in the bowl is worth $100 with a chance to win up to $500 in cold hard cash.
Take your place. Where she right. You starts here. Your starting line is right here.
Oh, right here. This
the
blue.
Bowl. That's
okay.
There. Okay.
That's
when I say ready, set, go, then you go. And
yeah.
Just Godspeed, okay?
Just your mouth.
No hands.
Just your mouth.
You can do it. Okay.
Okay.
On your mark. Get set, go.
Go.
Thank you.